Good morning, friends. Today we shall be discussing about sewer abundance. So far we have learned about what are the system of sanitation, what is sewage discharge, and how to do the hydraulic designs of sewers. We have also discussed the network of sewer line, that is sewerage system. And today we shall be discussing about sewer abundances. Sewer appurtenances are those structures which are constructed at a suitable interval along a sewerage system and help in its efficient operation and maintenance. So these are the different devices, which includes manholes, drop manholes, lamp holes, clean outs, street inlets, which is also called as a gullies, catch basins, flushing tanks, grease and oil traps, inverted siphons, and storm regulator. So first, let us start with discussing the manholes. Manholes can be defined as an opening of either circular or a rectangular in a shape. Mostly, it would enable the person to enter the sewer for inspection, cleaning, and flushing. That is a maintenance, which also serves as a ventilator for sewers by providing a perforated manhole covers. We have understood that domestic sewage sometimes goes under the process of decomposition and would emit some foul gases. So those gases need to be ventilated. These manholes would facilitate the laying of a sewer line at convenient length. Now, where manholes are provided? Generally, the manholes are provided at all junctions of two or more sewers. Whenever the diameter of sewer changes, let's say that our one sewer line, it is laid at 400 mm dia, and other, now it has been reduced at some of the places at, let's say, 300 mm dia. So whenever the diameter of sewer changes, this manhole is required to be placed. Whenever direction of a sewer line changes, unless like a water pipeline, in water pipeline we are providing the bends for changing in the direction. But for a sewer line, always whenever the direction of sewer line get changes, we require to provide a manhole. When sewers of different elevations joins together, one sewer line may be laid at let's say 0.9 meter from ground level, other is laid at let's say that 1.5 meter from ground level, then at those places we required to provide the manholes. The spacing of manholes, which is given by Indian standard 1742, it depends on a different diameter. If diameter is less than 0.3 meter, then spacing would be 45 meter. Up to 0.6 meter, it would be 75 meter. Up to 3 feet or 0.9 meter, it would be 90 meter. Up to 1.2 meter, let's say it would be 120 meter. Up to 1.5 meter, 250 meters. Above 150 meter, it would be 300 meter. Again, the minimum size also been specified by our Indian standard, that depth is less than 0.8 meter, then minimum size it required to be provided is 0.75 meter by 0.75 meter. This size should be sufficient enough for any personnel to go inside for possible cleaning, possible maintenance. If depth is between 0.8 to 2.1 meter, the minimum size suggested is 1.2 meter by 0.9 meter. And for greater than 2.1 meter of a depth, minimum it would be 1.2 by 0.9 meter. And if it is circular, then minimum diameter would be 1.4 meter. Now these manholes are classified according to their depth. If the depth of manhole is 0.7 to 0.9 meter, then it is considered as a shallow. If it is around 1.5 meter and the section do not change, then it is considered as a normal or medium. But if the depth is greater than 1.5 meter, it is considered as a deep manhole. for deep manholes, taps and etc. are to be provided for facilitating descending into the manhole. So this is a typical one of the diagram of a deep manhole, where the depth of a manhole is more. It is generally constructed with the masonry or a concrete. The walls are constructed with masonry or a concrete, which is having a bottom with having a proper gradient, which would facilitate the water to enter into the sewer, and which would no deposition would be occurred at the bottom. The steps are generally casted into the sides, made of a cast iron for easy ascending or descending into the manhole. Manhole is always covered with a frame, so it is known as a manhole with cover and frame. This is a typical section of a drop manhole. In this drop manhole, when the branch sewer enter a manhole by more than 0.5 to 0.6 meter above the main sewer, the sewage is generally not allowed to fall directly into the manhole, but it is brought into through the down pipe taken from a branch sewer. So this is a pipe which is taken from a branch sewer. This pipe may be a vertical or may be inclined, but whenever the branch sewer is connected to the manhole with a vertical pipe, it is known as a drop manhole. Instead of vertical pipe, if the pipe is provided at inclination, it is known as a ramp. Now, whenever for a drop manhole, if our branch sewer, which is at a higher elevation, which never allowed the discharge of domestic waste directly into the manhole, so it is now allowed through the vertical pipe. One plug is provided over here, which now stops in general whatever the water which is flowing into the drop manhole, but it is open whenever there is a need of inspection or a possible cleaning. Another appurtenance is a lamp hole. Lamp holes are the small openings on a sewer to permit the insertion of a lamp into the sewer. The lamp light is then viewed from the upstream as well as the downstream manhole. The obstructed light confirms the obstruction of a sewer. Generally, these lamp holes are made of a cast iron or vertical stoneware pipe, and it is provided with a cover. So from whenever inspection is required to be done, this cover is open and the lamp is lowered. Another appurtenance is a clean out. Clean out is nothing but a inclined pipe extending from a ground and connected to the underground sewer as shown in a figure. A clean out is used for cleaning of a sewer pipe. Generally, it is provided at the upper ends of lateral sewers in place of manholes. The functioning of clean out is very simple and consists in removing the top cover and forcing the water through the clean out pipe to the lateral sewer and remove the obstacles in a sewer pipeline. Another appurtenance is known as a street inlet, and also they are known as a gullies. They are opening on a road surface at a lower point for a draining rainwater from the roads and admitting into the underground sewers. So this inlet therefore located along a roadside or on a straight road, generally at the interval of 30 to 60 meter. These inlets will take a water, are provided maybe with cover with a grating at a top, or it, so this is a horizontal arrangement, or it could have a vertical arrangement. So storm water, whenever it is collected into the our straight inlet or a gullies, then this water, accumulated water, it goes into through this storm water sewer to the main our storm water sewers or combined sewers. Another is a catch basin or a catch pits. This is a similar to the inlet or gullies. Only difference is it is there would be a one storm water sewer which is having a hood and which is the having a shape of nearly to the U. So whenever any water enters, storm water enters through the horizontal grating covered with the openings, it may have some of the impurities, maybe the silt or some of the inorganic matter. If it is allowed to enter into our sewer, it may lead to a chalking up. So the impurity would settle and whatever the water, relatively cleaner, will go into the storm water drains. Another appurtenances which has been used for easy maintenance of a sewer pipeline is a flushing tanks. In a flushing tank, it is generally when the sewer are laid at a flat gradients, and if it is not producing a self-cleansing velocity, these flushing tanks are required. These devices store water temporarily and throw it into the sewer lines for a purpose of flushing and cleaning the sewer. So the flushing tank should have a sufficient volume or capacity to store the water, which would enable a easy flushing of the sewer lines. This is a typical figure for automatic kind of a flushing tank. Generally, when we do have a one sniff hole, there is a U tube which is having a level AB. Initially, when the tank is empty, the water level stand at AB into the U tube. As the water enters from a supply pipeline, these will start to get filled. Whenever the water reaches at more elevation than the sniff hole, some pressure would be created over here. This pressure would depress the line, the level at A. As the water level keeps on increasing, this level will keep depressed until it reaches at a bottom. At this point, whatever the water which is here in a chamber would start to flush through the enlarger pipe into the sewer line. So total water would enter into the sewer line, and whenever again the water goes more than the sniff line, then it is shut off and again the second operation would start. Next operation is a grease and oil trap. It may happen that in some of the domestic sewage, there is a presence of grease and oil. Maybe some of the garages or some of the restaurant might be discharging grease and oil. If this grease and oil are allowed to enter into our sewer pipeline, it may coat to the side. It would reduce the hydraulic capacity. It also happens that some of the particles would stick to the sides along with the grease. Again, it would reduce the capacity. Third thing, if this grease and oil, if it is allowed into the our treatment processes, it may chalk up some of the process and hinder the treatment facility. So it would be better to trap the grease and oil. So in typical grease and oil chamber, the water is accumulated over here, and then the water is taken from a bottom to another tank. As the grease and oil are lighter in nature compared to the water, this would float and it is cleaned at particular intervals. These are the inverted siphons. Whenever a sewer pipe has to be dropped below a hydraulic gradient line for passing it beneath a valley, a road, a railway, a stream, a tidal estuary, or any other depression in earth surface, or where it passes beneath some other obstruction in the path, it will be known as an inverted siphon or a depressed sewer. The sewage through such pipeline will not flow under gravity but will be flowing under the pressure, which is in the case of water pipeline. The last is a storm water regulator. Whenever there is a discharge from storm and sanitary flow which is combined, whenever there is a rain and there is a high discharge, the storm water along with the sanitary sewer would start to flow in. But providing this adjusting leap, some of the water may be controlled and part of storm water may directly go to the outfall, maybe directly, maybe discharge into the river. And here whatever we get would be a dry weather flow, or in another term it is a sanitary flow. So these are the different devices or appurtenances which is used for maintenance, repair and easy functioning of our sewerage system. I hope you have understood whatever which has been discussed, and now see you later with basics of sewage treatment.